is Gerald Perry, and I'm your instructor and host. This is a live broadcast where we talk about everything about gardening in Southern California, or California for the whole state, for that matter. And we talk about everything from apples to zinnias and trees to turf. We're live. You can call in with any questions you have about gardening in your garden or some plant material that you've seen somewhere that you might be interested in growing. Our phone number is 1-800-339-1193. I'll do my best to answer your questions. If not, I'll try and find the location where you can find an answer to your question, because I know a lot about the resources available and where you can go to get your answers. Now, we always start the show off with upcoming events. The 3-day for the Huntington Botanical Gardens is coming next week, March 4th. Now, unfortunately, I'm sure those tickets are gone. If you want to go to the 3-day at the Huntington Botanical Gardens, you need to call up very quickly at the beginning of the month and get your free tickets for the following month. So next week, if you call up the Huntington, you can get tickets for April. And there's a 3-day every month at the Huntington Botanical Gardens. And when you go on the 3-day, you cannot buy tickets. You need to keep your free tickets in advance. And you can call 800. You can call that number you saw on the screen. The Rare Fruit Society lecture and demo is coming up at the South Coast Botanical Gardens on March 7th from 1 to 4 p.m. And you can call 310-544-1948 for more information. That should be an excellent class. You can learn about growing some unusual fruits and how to take care of them. In addition to that, we have the African Violet Show and Sale coming up also at the South Coast Botanical Gardens on March 13th from 1 to 4. If you enjoy growing African violets, or if you just want to get into it, this would be a great time to go. You can purchase some really, really beautiful varieties at this show and learn all the requirements that these plants have. They do really well on a windowsill, and they're an excellent house plant. In addition to that, we have the Monster Tomato and Pepper Sale coming up at the Florida Arboretum on March 18th through the 21st from 9 to 4 p.m. This is where you can go and get some really unusual tomato varieties and some pepper, types of peppers. You can get heirloom tomatoes and also get a lot of information on growing tomatoes and peppers, and they'll have a lot of other things for sale as well. In addition to that, we don't have any other upcoming events. The last week we were talking about integrated pest management, and we covered a lot of issues in integrated pest management. Of course, central to the theme of integrated pest management is planting, making sure you're putting plants in the right locations, selecting plants that are appropriate for your area, and correct identification of a pest when you want to do something about that pest. I wanted to show you some common pests. We talked about a lot of the common pests: aphids, mealybugs, thrips. These are the soft-bodied sucking insects, scale, white fly. They're all fairly easy to control with oils and soaps. And just recently, a colleague where I work at the Los Angeles County Department of Agriculture, where I'm a senior biologist, plant pathologist, one of my colleagues is out on disability, and he had a lot of orchids in his office. And unfortunately, they went dry and they wilted a little bit, so I went in to take a look at them, and they were covered with mealybugs. So I just want to show you what the mealybugs did to these plants. Let's bring them over here. Here's one of the ones from his office. And when I got it, it was just solid white mealybug. And if we go to the overhead camera, you can see what happens when you let the infestation get out of your hand. And this is the Phalaenopsis orchid, very, very popular orchid. I'll show you another one in a minute in full bloom. But if you just lift this up, let me just spin this in. But if you lift this leaf up, this is the new leaf, it's very tender. And you can see all this damage on the back of the leaf here. And this was all from mealybug. I washed it off. Mealybugs are fairly easy to control, either with a soapy water with an oil spray, or just a strong spray of water to wash them off. But on Phalaenopsis, and they tend to like Phalaenopsis, basically when you grow them indoors on a windowsill, they'll get on to Phalaenopsis pretty regularly at some point during the year. And they get down into the leaf axis, down in the very base of the leaf, where it's very difficult to get them out. Now, you know, on the back of this leaf, that was easy to wash them off, but they get way down there. So I brought my scope home, all from his office, so I could water them and fertilize them and clean up this infestation of mealybug. And, you know, this is kind of permanent damage, as you know, because the infestation got out of hand. So I brought one down below here, another one way over, another one over here. And I kind of cleaned them all up with some soapy water. But now the thing to remember is that soaps and oils have no residual activity. And so the pests can come back fairly quickly. And so you typically, even on your outdoor materials, if you're using soaps and oils, you need to spray once a week for about 3 weeks to really clean up the plant and then monitor it and see if it starts coming back. So here's another orchid he had, and there's no label, so I'm not familiar with what this could be. It could be an oncidium, it could be other things. But I noticed this morning that the mealybug is starting to come back. You see this little tiny white right there. If you flip over the leaf, let's flip over this leaf and take a look. There's the mealybug coming back. This looks like the two-tailed mealybug. It doesn't really matter which species. There are many, many species of mealybugs. And so I can see that within just a week, the ones that I didn't get with the soapy water are starting to reproduce. And a lot of these second insects reproduce very rapidly. This plant itself is a little sad. You know, a lot of these orchids we grow, you can purchase them in the nursery. They're beautiful, they have a beautiful flower spike. They do require high humidity. They don't like icy hot temperatures. Some of them are very sensitive to hard water. And so they can be a challenge to get to do well in our own homes, unless you have a greenhouse. And then greenhouses are a lot of work. You gotta keep the lawn cleaned up. It's a great place for bugs to grow, as well as your plants. So, I know now that I need to take all those phonopsis that I brought home of my colleagues and treat them again with some either soapy water or maybe some oil. Oil and water, like a olive oil or some sprinkled fine, some type of horticultural oil. Now, if I really get fed up with it and I don't want to keep treating every week, I can reach for a broad spectrum insecticide like Malathion or 7. And I usually don't do that unless I feel that I'm just not keeping clean. I do that sometimes with scale insects because scale insects are far more difficult to control. With oils and soaps, you can keep them down, but they're more difficult because they're covered with a hard covering that they secrete that protects them from oils and soaps. So if I use a harsher material, a stronger material, like 7, which is a carbamate, or malathion, which is organophosphate, they clean up scale quite nice. And also, sometimes they're down in the leaf axils, and it's really a challenge to clean them up in the other materials, the 7, malathion, things like that, will be more effective in cleaning the axils, get down to the leaf axils. So, but I don't use them very often. I do often use them, though, when I get ants. Small Arctic ants will often come in and colonize one of my pots, or several of my pots. Yeah, I have a greenhouse window over my kitchen sink that's on the south side of my house. It's very bright. I stretch shade cloth across it to shade the plants that are in there. I grow a whole bunch of different stuff in there. And the ants love it in there. And they'll get into one of my pots, and they're hard to get rid of. So typically, I'll start with soapy water to try and get rid of the soapy water, kills the ants quite nicely. But if I get fed up with it, sometimes I'll go get one of the broad spectrum insecticides and treat the whole pot with that just to be done with it. Because, you know, with the soapy water, I'll have to repeat that several times. So I do want to remind our viewers that we're live and we will take any calls you have at 1-800-339-1193. You can also email us and watch us on the internet at dhtv.csudh.edu. Now, one of the other things I wanted to talk about was some of the diseases that affect peaches and all stone fruits for that matter, but particularly peaches. And talk about how you integrate your control of these diseases. So, you know, some of them are fairly easy to control and others are more problematic. One very common disease that you see on peaches is called peach leaf curl, caused by a fungus called Tephrina deformans. And let's bring this up full screen. And peach leaf curl is like a galling on the leaf. You see this swelling on the leaf right here. And often you'll get these pink or red colors in this swollen part that there. We can bring up the next picture as well. And take a look at that one. That one shows a little more of the red. And you can see how it's all swollen here. And here's a little more of the red. Now, here in Southern California, beech leaf curl is more of this kind of a nuisance disease. It's interesting. It doesn't really hurt the trees very much because as soon as it stops ripening, it's after the spring months, the disease will go away on its own. Up north, in Northern California or in Washington, where it rains extensively through the spring, you'll get extensive infection of the leaves, and it will defoliate the trees. And if you don't control it, that repeated defoliation over year after year after year will seriously damage your peach tree. And long term, it's really very bad for your tree. Now, this is a fairly easy disease to control on your peaches. During the dormant season, when the tree has no foliage, you can spray it with a dormant oil mixed with a fungicide. Typically, sulfur works very well, but almost any prospective fungicide will also work. And what you only need to spray once or twice, that's because the fungus that causes this disease, Tamfrina, survives on the bark of the tree during the winter months in a yeast-like phase, because it really has two different phases. One is the yeast phase, where it buds and grows like a yeast, and the other is when it infects the leaves and starts growing more like a filamentous fungi. So just one or two sprays during the dormant season with a dormant oil. Now, you can't use dormant oils when the tree has leaves on it, it will burn the foliage, and that's a good warning for whenever you use oils. Be careful. If you use oils and it's over 90 degrees, you can burn the foliage. And dormant oils will almost always burn the foliage regardless of temperature. So the summer oils are usually more dilute or an oil that is less phytotoxic than the dormant oils that are used when trees have no foliage on them. So that's a fairly easy disease to control. One or two sprays during the winter with the oil and the sulfur, and you should get 100% control. During very wet seasons, when it rains a whole lot, that's when you need to do two sprays during the winter, and even a third if you really wanted to schedule that. Now, the other disease, which is a lot more difficult to control and very common on peaches, is brown rot. Now, brown rot, and we can see behind me, the actual mummy, what we call a mummy. It's a peach that got infected last year and then fell on the ground. And in the spring, when the tree starts to flower and it's raining, it produces these cups. These are all little cups, and they're the same thing as a mushroom. In the lining of the cup, inside the cup, the cups are about the size of a dime or so. And lining the inside of these cups are microscopic sacs. And inside the sacs are these spores. And when the wind blows or you come up and kind of tap a little bit, they puff the spores out of these cups. And the spores float in the air and land on the flowers and infect the flowers. And that's the flower phase of the infection. And it can ruin the flower, and you won't get fruit from that flower. Or it can infect the new young fruit, and you get a quiescent infection of the fruit. You don't see it, and it won't become obvious until the fruit starts to ripen. So a lot of times you don't know that you're dealing with this disease until June or July, and your fruit will develop little tiny brown dots that quickly enlarge, and the entire fruit turns brown. That's why it's called brown rot. And we can take a quick look at photograph number 11, and you can see what a brown rotted peach looks like. We'll bring this up. In addition to the spores that are produced in your cups, it produces the spores on the infected fruit as well. So you can see the spores being produced here. This picture is from the University of California statewide IBM project, and they have a wonderful website, the UC Davis IBM website. And so this very quickly rots the whole fruit. Once you get to the fruit stage of this disease, there's not a lot you can do about it. You have to control the disease in the flower stage. So what's done commercially, and what you can do in your garden as well, is you can spray the tree with a broad spectrum fungicide. What's available for homeowners are things like Fungiway, Funginex, or Decanil, and you spray at what they call first pink, and that's when the flowers just start to open. You see a little tiny bit of pink, but the petals are now exposed to the air. And this isn't a flower disease, so what you're really doing is you're coating the petals with the fungicide, and that will prevent the spores from infecting the flower. Now, what you need to spray at first pink, you need to spray it about 5 to 7 days after that when the flowers are fully open, and you may want to use a third spray after about 10 to 14 days after the first spray. And this will give you very good control of the flower phase, and then you'll get really no or very little infection of the fruit itself. If you don't control the flower phase, and you try to spray later and spray the fruit itself, that's usually not very effective, and you can have very high losses. Now, there is one aspect of this disease, is that you usually get very little disease in a dry spring. If it's not raining when the tree flowers, you can even skip spraying entirely, unless you've had a history of brown rot in your trees, in your peach trees, and nectarines. And this also affects the other stone fruits, but not to the same extent as it does peaches and nectarines. So if you have a history of this disease, then you should probably go ahead and spray at first pick, even if you don't have any rain at that particular moment. We've had a lot of rain in the spring, and I'll bet you see a lot of brown rot in June and July when the peaches start to ripen. When the fruit is green, the infections aren't visible. And as soon as the fruit starts to ripen, they get these little brown dots, and they enlarge very rapidly, and the whole fruit turns brown. Now, you can't depend entirely on these fungicide treatments when the tree is flowering. What you really want to do is also reduce the amount of spores that are in the air, and the spores that you produce right around your own tree. So, in the winter, you want to make sure that you clean up any old fruit that is on the ground. You want to get rid of any weeds that have grown around your tree as well, because the weeds can create a higher humidity right on the surface of the soil, and then the fruit will be tucked down in the weeds under there, and that high humidity allows those cups, which are called apothecia, that's the actual name of those cups, and so you want to get rid of the weeds so you don't have that high humidity right on the surface of the soil, and pick up any of the old fruit, and any fruit that's hanging in the tree that was infected last year and shriveled up and became what we call a mummy. And let's take a look at a mummy. It's photograph number 12. And this is a brown rot mummy. We'll bring this up full screen. And here it is. This is a mummy that's hung still up in the tree. So what's going to happen is in the spring, when the tree starts to bloom and it's green, you're going to get the cups formed right on here, or you can even get some of the asexual spores produced on here. And they're going to drift off and land on the flowers and start the infection. So it's very important that you remove all the mummies and all the old fruit from the surface of the soil that are still hanging in the tree. The other thing is when you prune in December or January, you always want to prune your peach trees and all your stone fruits every winter. In December or January, when they are dormant, and you want to remove any infected wood, because the fungus can not only infect the flowers, but it will run down the pedestal of the flower and into the twigs, and infect the twigs and small branches, and you can get these cankers, and you can also get spore fruits there. And we can take a quick look at number 10. This is actually a different fungus, and we'll bring this up full screen. And you can see that this twig is infected, and the flower has been, I'm just lucky that was there. Here's a flower, and here's another shoot that got infected and was killed, but this was killed by the shot hole fungus. And shot hole is a slightly different problem in peach. We'll talk about that briefly in a minute. But when you see these type of infections, and you can see a canker, often it'll move right down in here and infect the twig. So in the winter months, you need to go in and prune out any infected wood. That didn't happen when you prune peach trees. We'll talk about that more in a coming show on how to prune your peach trees. You're a little past the time to prune because they're going to start flowering now. And starts with wood. It does a number of things. First, you remove any affected wood from either shot hole fungus or brown rot. And the first response to pruning is rapid new growth. So you get a lot of new growth. That new growth, the new wood, will flower better and produce more fruit. So what you're doing is reinvigorating the tree when you prune in the winter with new young growth that flowers better and produces more fruit. It opens it up, you get more airflow, and it improves the health of your tree. So the other disease that you might see on your peach trees and nectaries is powdery mildew. And let's go, I'll show you powdery mildew on a peach on photograph number 7. Bring that up full screen, and here you can see this white powdery growth all over the fruit. You can also get on the leaves and the small twigs, and this will start early in the spring. And powdery mildews are not that difficult to control. Let's also take a look at number 8, photograph number 8. And you can see the powdery mildew often forms on the young peaches as these white little patches that are, you know, the peaches themselves are very furry. Of course, nectaries aren't. They're really a peach without fur, or without the trichomes, the little hairs. And so, but this will start on the peaches. Now, typically what you want to do in the first, if you see this started at all on your peaches or on the leaves, is your first selection would be a sulfur dust. And sulfur is a lot like oils. You have to be careful not to use it when it's over 90 degrees. So in the spring, this is the best time to use oils and sulfurs. And you can use the oil as a sprayer, a sticker with the sulfur, or just dust it. And sulfur is very effective to control powdery mildew. If the powdery mildew starts coming back after a few weeks, then you can go to styling oil or neem oil. Styling oil is a little more difficult to obtain, in that you're going to have to look for it on the internet and find it to sell it. I don't see it for sale in most garden centers or nurseries. But you can get neem oil at almost any garden center. It has a good antifungal activity. The other thing you can use is potassium bicarbonate, and there are now potassium bicarbonate fungicides on the market. You can get those at a lot of garden centers, and potassium bicarbonate is organic in that it's not a toxin. It's kind of a natural compound, and it's very effective in controlling powdery mildew, not just on your fruit trees, but also things like roses and crepe myrtle. A whole variety of plants that get these different powdery mildews. Now, if you've seen any of these diseases on your peach trees, and you have any questions about it, give us a call. Our number is 1-800-339-1193. Now, the other disease that I was talking about is shot hole. And let's take a look at some pictures of shot hole, also from the UC Davis IDEA website. This is number 9. And if we can bring that up. And bring that up full screen. We'll take a look at it now. What happens is the infections start on the leaves or on the young fruit, and there'll be these little brown spots with a purple edge. And then as they expand, the center will turn brown on the leaves, and then they'll fall out like some shot the leaf. And on the fruit, you see these little lesions. This is a little more difficult to control. I showed you earlier. Photograph number 10, we might as well go back to that and take a look. Shot hole can affect the twigs and destroy, and you can destroy the flowers when they're infected, move down through the twigs and into the branches, and you'll get gumming either with brown rot or shot hole fungi infecting the twigs. You get this is kind of a gum right here. You see this right there, that's a gumming that's coming out. So during the winter, again, you prune out any affected branches, and then you can spray with a broad-spectrum fungicide when you start to see new growth in the spring. If shot hole has been a problem in the past on your peaches. So you can see that if you integrate your control strategies for these diseases, a lot of the materials that control brown rot also control shot hole. And so your pruning practices also control both diseases. And then with just an oil and a sulfur spray in the winter, you can control the peach leaf curl. Some people get confused about peach leaf curl. This is pruning leaves on their peaches, and they think because he's curling off, and that is aphids that are feeding on the back, so they're usually causing them to curl. And that's not the same as ancient curl. Ancient curl would be those red to yellowish, swollen leaves, and the leaves become badly distorted. But again, it's usually just really kind of a minor disease in Southern California, and much worse up in the north where it rains a lot. Now, I have some folks I want to show you, and I showed you one last week, and this is the Integrated Pest Management Guide for Stone Fruits. And we've been talking just right now about peaches, and this is published by the University of California Integrated Cooperative Extension Natural Resources Division, and Agricultural Natural Resources, and it covers all the problems you can get with peaches, nectarines, apricots, plums, cherries, all the problems you have in California, all the insect pests. It talks about fertilization, it talks about watering. They have a series of these. So this is the one on stone fruits. Yeah, this is the one on apples and pears. So if you're interested particularly in one particular type of fruit, like if you're really a nut for stone fruits, and you grow all sorts of peaches and nectarines and apples, then you want to maybe get that one. If you like to grow apples and pears, then you might want to get this one. But they have them on almost every major crop in California. So you probably don't want the one on alfalfa or wheat, but they have that as well. There's quite a few of them, and these are kind of the biggest ones. And they talk about all the different problems that you get on those types of fruit. And you can find those very easily. Integrated pest management for apples and pears, or integrated pest management for stone fruits, and you'll find them very persistent. Now, there's one more book I'd like to show you. We're going to take a look at a few books. This is the Street Tree Seminar book on street trees recommended for Southern California. It shows about, let me move this a little bit, I've got the one there. You can see the street trees recommended for Southern California from Street Tree Seminar. And it has about, I guess about 100 trees in it. And it shows the full picture of the tree, the full size tree, the bark, and what the trunk looks like. And then it'll show the leaf and the flower, or the fruit. It'll show the interesting things about it. And then over here on the information page, it's going to tell you the name of the tree, the appropriate cutout for the tree, because this is oriented towards street trees, how big a cutout it requires, how big a parkway it requires, and then any problems it has for it. If it has a particular insect problem or a disease problem, and they'll talk about that in the notes here. You can order this from Street Tree Seminar, and this is the newest edition. There is another older edition. And if you call in and you want to get a copy of that, I can give you the phone number. We are live on the air, so if you want to give us a call, at 800-339-1193. Now, the other book I'll show you real quick. This is I started collecting paper pavilions and just handed them over to me a while back. This is a book I probably bought 20 or 30 years ago myself, Pavilions by Victoria Padilla. Now, this is probably out of print, but I pulled it off my library out of my bookcase this morning because I wanted to show you the other book first. This is Tillandsia's. I actually showed this to you last fall. Paul Isley, who owns a nursery in Torrance called Rainforest Flora, and he specializes in bromeliads and staghorn ferns and some other really nice plant material. And he's a real expert on Tillandsia's. Tillandsia's are bromeliads. They are a real unique group of bromeliads. They're air plants. Really, all the bromeliads are kind of like air plants. They don't really need to be watered on the roots. You water them in a cup. Tillandsia is all you do is mist it. They'll grow on anything. They'll grow on rocks. They'll grow on telephone lines. They grow, and you can just tie them onto a piece of wood and mist them, and they do quite well. And this is a really spectacular book. You can go down to his nursery and get that, or look for it on Amazon or whatever website that you prefer to order your books on. So I had to get it. It was just such a beautiful book. But I wanted me show you a little demonstration real quick before we go into today's lecture. One last thing before we move on to our little demonstration. Here's one of the Phalaenopsis that I was growing, that I grow at home. And you can see a common problem that I get because I don't get to it quick enough. Is when you apply a Phalaenopsis, and this is the Phalaenopsis orchid, the butterfly orchid, or the moth orchid, I should say, not the butterfly orchid, the moth orchid. And this is probably, I'll just tip it over and show you those flowers. The flowers are spectacular, they last up to 3 or 4 months. And they'll remove fairly easily if they're in a bright window. But they are very sensitive to full sun, and I want to show you what happens when you get the full sun. You get this big burn here on the leaf. And like I said, the greenhouse window on my, here's that burn. You see that right there? That's because the full sun hit that, and it fried it for me. I have that southern window. Southern windows are very bright and warm. And if the sun comes in, it hits the leaves, it'll burn. So on an eastern exposure, you're probably less likely to burn. But they sit in these beautiful spikes. And when you buy a new one, it'll be nice and straight and tied off to a little bit of stick. And in a greenhouse, they tend to grow real straight anyway. But in my window, they tend to grow sideways. And so that's always a challenge because then if you're really leggy, they want to tip over. But I wanted to show you the sunburn that you can get on these. They are tender. You can't grow them outdoors in the winter. They need to be inside. You can't grow them outdoors during the spring and summer and the fall as long as you don't have them in the full sun. And they do need a little bit of bright light in order to flower. I'm going to let that just tip over there a little bit. And I see we have a caller, so let's go to our first caller. Terry, caller from South Pasadena, you're on the air.
Yeah, I had a question about daffodils. I noticed them all over town, and I was wondering, when do you plant them?
Well, you're right. They're blooming all over town right now. I've got a few blooming in my garden. They're planted in the fall, usually around October or November. So if you see things that are blooming now, it's not the right time to plant it now. You need to get them in early. They do require full sun. So you want to put them where they're going to get a lot of sun. You also, one of the things that people used to do a lot is when you dig the hole, you have to plant the bulb itself about 2.5 times the size of the bulb. So if the bulb is like about a 2-inch bulb, you're going to plant it about 6 or 7 inches deep. But one of the things that I learned a long time ago when I was gardening in the San Gabriel Valley from some of the old timers who were my clients used to mow their lawns and stuff, was that you dig a little deeper and put a little bone meal underneath them, and then cover that with a little soil, and then plant them like that on top of that. And that bone meal will really get them going good. They like a lot of phosphorus, and that bone meal is high in phosphorus. So I would try that as well. You can get a lot of different types of daffodils. Now, the genus is Narcissus, and there are the little small ones that people would usually just call Narcissus, or the big ones that people call daffodils. King Alfred is the bright yellow one with the big tubular petals. And there's just a whole variety of colors. You can get them in many colors, and they naturalize very, very nicely. So it's a wonderful plant material from Southern California. They don't require the chill that other bulbs would require, such as tulips or peonies, which are very difficult to grow in Southern California. So, and now you do want to give them a little fertilizer and water them regularly, probably about once a week, once they start coming up. Now, during the winter, if it's raining, you obviously don't need to water. But at this point, if we stop raining, we've had a lot of rain this winter, but eventually it's going to stop, you're going to need to keep watering them until the leaves turn brown. That usually happens sometime around June or July. The leaves will start to shrivel up and turn brown. And try to remember you planted those bulbs there because if you dig in that area, you might cut them and that can lead to rot. Now, over time, they tend to thin out and you start losing a few, and so you can add more in over the years. But they naturalize and they repeat them quite easily in Southern California.
Oh, great. Well, thank you so much. Enjoy your show.
Okay, well, thank you for calling and thank you for watching the show. Now, what I wanted to show you next was. One of the reasons I'm kind of getting excited that I enjoy growing bromeliads is because once I buy a bromeliad, I've really got it for life if I don't screw it up. So let's pull this up here, and I want to show you one bromeliad that I bought some time ago. And this one is really pretty, and they're really quite showy. Now you can get bromeliads with, you know, really spectacular color in the leaves themselves. This one is it's called Samba. It's a Neoregalia is the genus, Neoregalia. And Samba is a cultivated variety. And you grow it because of this bright red color. I mean, that's just actually spectacular. Now, this one's getting a little bit for a long time. What I have to do with one of these is really keep a little water in the cup here. This one gets all the Neoregalias bloom deep in the bowl or the cup. And they don't sit out along the skin like others do. And typically, those that do that, that have low flowering, then the center will turn red to attract hummingbirds, because most of these are hummingbird pollinated in their native areas. Or, you know, this red attracts the pollinators. So they're really quite spectacular. This one's getting a little old. You can also see that they have a little full sun on it. These can take the full sun in the afternoon. So morning light and then really well. An eastern exposure or a southern exposure to shade cold. And what this particular one has done, and they all do really, is it has grown two new plants on the side of it. And so once it does that, and once we get a little big, I'll just pop this off. It should come off really easily. Last time I tried to do this on the show, I screwed it up. And I just screwed it up. And there we go. Came right off. And there's the pot. And you can see here, there's plant growing right here. And on the other side, there's another one right there. Now, there's a couple things you might want to do. You can either just cut off the other plant completely and throw it away, and let these two pups grow, and you get a clump. Now, I found, personally, that if I take these pups off and pop them separately, they get bigger. And I like a slightly larger plant. So, sometimes you just pull it off like that. And there you go. Now, all I have to do is pop that up, and I'll pull the other one off as well. Now, sometimes when you pull these off, you might actually stimulate another one to grow. And typically, most of the time, that doesn't happen for me. When they pull those pups off, often this plant will not really deteriorate, and it's done. I'll hang on to it until it really looks horrible, and hope that I'll get another pup off of it, although that's not likely. Let's just set that over there out of the way. Now, here we got these new plants, or a little bromeliad. And what you want to do is get a nice potting mix that has good drainage. And so I brought some potting mix with me. And they do need very good drainage. That's all plants really want, good drainage, except those that are swamps. And so I'll just fill up this pot with a little soil. And now we're going to need a lot of soil, so I'll go ahead and fill it to where the edge is. Now, I only have to put a little tiny bit of it in there. That's it. That's pot. Now, this is going to want to fall over because it hasn't grown any roots. So I'm going to use broken pieces of clay pots. And I've broken lots of clay pots over the years, and I keep a big thing of. So I'll just set a few of these in here. Just like that, just to hold it up. And now I just put the end in. This end just goes in about maybe a half inch or so into the soil, and it will start growing roots from there. Not real fast. Over the next 2 or 3 months, it'll start rooting into the soil. I'm not going to water the soil very often. I'm going to water the soil maybe once every couple weeks, but I'm going to keep watering the cup. So I want to keep the water in there and water that soil sparingly, because there's not a lot of roots in that soil, and I don't want that soil to be soaking wet all the time. I just want it to be moist to stimulate some root growth. If you want, you can even put a little rooting hormone on here and stimulate faster root growth. So that's how you pull the pumps off with a boom of it, and just sit in a pot with some potting mitts, with some ice cold water here on my table. I gotta always remember that these Rebellions have water in their cups, and that they spill quite easily. So that's a very easy way to propagate your Rebellions. They grow these pumps off the base, and so you buy one, and that one costs me $6.50. I get to watch it bloom and have that beautiful red in the foliage, and then it gives me two new plants. And over time, you can end up with quite a few of them, and then you can trade them with your friends. And that's part of the joy of gardening, is propagating some of the more some of the things that you like to grow, and then trading with other people and getting other species and other types of Rebellions. And I kind of like Rebellions. I'm starting to grow more of them. Now today I want to move on and lecture on how to water your garden. And there's some very important concepts there. And I want to get this water away from my notes. I should have brought the towel with me. The way you water a landscape is fairly technical. And you water a landscape the same way that, well, at least we measure how you water a landscape, the same way we measure rainfall. So if we say rain is a half an inch, inch, that's actually the same way you water a landscape. You put down a half an inch, or you put down an inch. And to know that, you have to know, to know how much you put down, you have to know your application rate. How fast or how much water do your sprinklers apply on an hourly basis? Do they apply an inch an hour? Do they apply 2 inches an hour? So the way you figure that out is you put cups all over the area where your sprinklers spray, and you run the sprinklers for about 15 minutes, and then you measure the depth in all the cups. Now, this is most applicable to a lawn, and I'll say this, I've said it many times, lawns use more water than any other aspect in your garden. They will, in a high on the valley particularly, they will use 3 to 4 feet of water per year, so lawns use a lot of water. Nothing else uses that much water. Shrubs and trees will use roughly about half that much. Maybe some of the higher water use shrubs will use 3/4 of them. But, so you put those cups out, let's talk about lawns, because lawns, we will move on from lawns and compare how to water shrubs and trees to how you water your lawn. So you put these cups all over your lawn. You can just use coffee cups, any straight-sided cup, and you can put out about 10 of them. Run the sprinkler system for 15 minutes. Go measure the depth in all the cups, and then take an average. It's going to tell you two things. It's going to tell you your application rate in inches per hour, and it's going to tell you whether you have even distribution, because in lawns, you have to have even distribution. You can't have one part of your lawn getting twice as much water as another part, because that part that it's half as much is going to divert poorly, or you're going to water enough for the dry part, and you're going to flood the other part. So, say you measure, one cup has a half an inch, and another cup has a tenth of an inch. Well, you have a problem with the design, or you've got a clogged head, or something like that. So you can address that. Now, most of our newer sprinkler systems, with these standard pop-up sprinklers, put out upwards of 2 inches per hour. And that can be a problem, because a lot of soils will not absorb water at that rate, and so you get a lot of runoff. And so you typically have to run just long enough before runoff, and then you can do a repeat application an hour or 2 hours later if you've got a runoff problem. Or you can switch to different types of heads that have a slower application rate and allow the water to soak in and water the soil. Now, so that's your application rate. You really have to know your application rate before you can move on in irrigating your landscape. The other thing you need to know is how much water you lose from your soil on a daily, weekly, or monthly basis. And that changes from season to season. It's called evapotranspiration. Evapotranspiration, or ET, is the total water loss from the soil through movement through the plant or evaporation from the surface of the soil. ET rates are well known historically throughout California and really all of North America. And here in Southern California, we lose about an inch a week in this spring and the fall in the hot in the valleys, and in the summer we'll lose 2 inches. Right along the coast, you'll lose about 3/4 of an inch in the spring and the fall, and 1.5 inches in the summer months. The deserts will quickly move up to 3 inches per week by before the end of spring. And so during the summer months, you're losing 3 inches a week in the desert areas. And you'll start off at about 1 inch a week, but you quickly, you know, in the spring, you quickly get up to 1.5 inches, and then 2 and then 3 inches a week in the summer for the desert areas. The deserts, there's a lot of water to keep a lot alive, even more than the hot in the valleys. Now, evapotranspiration is really a reference. And the reference is based on how much water would a cool season grass, which would be a fescue, like marathon or medallion, those are registered names of tall fescue grasses that are used extensively in Southern California. And how much water would that use if it were in an open field in full sun under normal conditions and you gave it all the water it could use? That's what the evapotranspiration rate is based on. So if you had that type, if you had a tall fescue growing in an open field in a hot oak valley in the spring and the fall, we'd use an inch a week. That's a lot of rain. That's a lot of water. And in the summer, it goes to 2 inches in the hot oak valleys. So in addition to that, you've got what we call a crop coefficient, which means how much does this particular species use compared to that tall fescue. So some species use very, very little water. They'll use 10% of ET. Things like aloes or cactus or a lot of California natives, they'll use 10, 20, or 30% of ET. A lot of other plants will use anywhere from 40% up to about 60% of ET. And of course, a tall fescue, even though the ET rate is based on a tall fescue, that for irrigating it in a landscape, we irrigate at 80% of ET. It doesn't need all of it to do well. You can water it at 100% of ET. It doesn't need it. It will do well at 80% of ET. And so if you have a tall fescue lawn in the San Gabriel Valley or the San Fernando Valley, you need to water it a little less than 1 inch a week in the spring and fall, and a little less than 2 inches a week in the summer. So that would be about 80% or 0.8 inches in the spring and fall and 1.6 inches a week in the summer. And generally speaking, you're not even that accurate in measuring your application rate to worry too much about the difference between 0.8 and 1, although 1.6 and 2 is a huge difference. Now, fruit trees typically use about 2/3 of ET. So citrus uses about 65% of ET, which means if you're growing an orange tree or lemon or grapefruit and you're in a hot in the valley, then you're going to water it about 0.6 inches a week in the spring and the fall and about 1.2 inches a week in the summer months. But they don't like to be watered frequently. Lawns are only rooted to a depth of about 6 inches, maybe if you're lucky down to 8 or 10 inches. That upper surface of the soil dries out rapidly. So lawns need to be watered twice a week in the spring and the fall, and up to 3 times a week in the summer months. Whereas shrubs and trees don't need to be watered that frequently. They root to a depth of 2 to 3 feet, and those lower profiles of the soil, once you get them wet, they'll stay wet for several weeks, and there's plenty of moisture down there for the plant. So shrubs can be watered about, both shrubs can be watered about twice a month in the spring and the fall, and about once a week in the summer. That would be your higher water use plants, like camellias or azaleas or gardenias. Things like junipers can be watered once a month in the spring and the fall. The really low water use plant materials, once a month in the spring and the fall, and twice a month in the summer. Now, if we got particularly hot in the summer, in maybe August or September, and we were over 100 degrees, you might do an extra watering and water them once a week. But it's really not necessary. They're tough, and they can take an awful lot of dry conditions. For things like junipers, aloes, agaves, all the different cactus. water really frequently, you're going to get a lot of weeds. That is one of the problems with root cactus. So, now, I do want to show you something I've read out on the internet. I'm going to show you the cover page. And I want to show you this, and if you're really interested in how to water properly, let's go to the overhead, because this is just a piece of paper. It's hard to hold it up. And this is estimating irrigation needs of landscape plants in California. And it's from, I don't know if you can read that, it's too small. It's the University of California Cooperative Extension and the California Department of Water Resources. And this talks about how you water a landscape of garden. Now, in agriculture, they do, they put out an inch or they put out 2 inches and they build the crop coefficient. But you've got many acres of one crop, all orange trees. So you know you need to water at 65% of BT, of evapotranspiration. And that's pretty straightforward. But if you're growing a landscape with a wide diversity of plant materials, all the plants need different water needs. And this goes back to planting. You do want to group your plants by water need and by whether they can take the full sun or they have to be in the shade. But it's really important that you don't mix plants that, you know, that need a lot of water with plants that need very little water. So if you've got rosemary, which is extremely drought tolerant, you don't grow it right next to fuchsias, because fuchsias need a lot of water, or ferns. You shouldn't be mixing those types of plants, because it is very difficult. But this publication addresses how to water a landscape, and that the factors are the species diversity. You're going to take all the different species, take their crop coefficients, and average them. You're going to look at the density of the planting. If it's high density, medium density, or low density, high density needs more water. Low density needs less water. And then you're going to look at your microclimate. Do you have high winds in a windy area that you live in? Is it an area with a lot of reflected heat, like a big white wall facing the south that reflects a lot of heat? That's going to need more water than a northern exposure that stays cool and gets a little more shade. So, that's what this booklet addresses. It talks about how you average those crop coefficients, and then you also apply your density factor and your microclimate factor, and that gives you a percent of ET for watering a mixed bed of plants. It's not really practical for an individual homeowner to address it that much, but it's very important for parks, golf courses, areas with large plantings, and they can get a lot of water savings by using this this technique. What's really interesting about this publication is they give you the crop coefficients. So I want to look at a few crop coefficients. And they break it down into very low, low, moderate, or high. And those very low, a plant that requires very low is 10% of BT or less. Low is 10 to 30% of BT or less. Moderate is 40 to 60% of ET. And high would be 70 to 90% of ET. So an example would be ferns or lawns are high water use because they're going to need 70 to 90% of the evapotranspiration rate. Moderate would be things like citrus or camellias. Camellias are not high water use, they're moderate water use. And established camellias that have been around a long time, many years, can be treated almost more like a low water use. You can water the lower range of that moderate. You can water them about 40 to 50% of ET rather than up around 60% of ET. And things like cactus are going to be very low, and a lot of California natives are going to be very low or low. And let's just take a look. Let's look up rosemary. This is how many pages is this? This is 148 pages or a little more than that. Maybe I printed this on my computer just a whole reel of paper. Let's see. But you can order a copy from the Water Resources Board and it'll get free. So it's 150 pages. It's free. You can download it off the internet, or you can order it from the Department of Water Resources Bulletins and Reports at P.O. Box 942836, Sacramento, California. And their phone number is 916-653-1097. If you didn't get that call, I'll give it to you again. And thank God. And for me, this is really excellent because I've always wanted to know the crop coefficients for various plants. I want to know what they say. Now, not only do they get the crop coefficients for the plants, they get the crop coefficients according to where you grow the plant. Because a plant being grown right along the coast doesn't need as much water as a plant that's being grown in a hot valley or a high desert area where they're going to need a lot more water. So they do break that down into six regions. And I want to look up rosemary because rosemary is a very, very low water use plant, and I expect it's going to say that. Let's take a quick look at rosemary. List a lot of plants. That's why I like this book so much, is it really lists almost everything. And rosemary should be here. Now, salvias. Salvias are a wonderful group. The salvias, in general, are mostly moderate water use. So you can be watering most of your salvias around 40 to 60% of DT. And you can be adjusting that according to the microclimate and your density. But rose bushes themselves are considered fairly moderate, but in the high desert, very high water use. So, but I tend to, most people tend to water their roses more, up to twice a week, even in the summer months, especially in the Honolulu valleys. The rosemary is low water use, except in the high desert, even in the Inland Empire, in the interior valleys that are hot, like the San Diego Valley or the Santa Fernando Valley. You can water that at about 30% of ET. So that's about a third of an inch a week in the spring and the fall, and about two-thirds of an inch, or 60%, roughly two-thirds, during the summer. But you're not going to want to put that down every week. You're going to want to put it down about every 2 weeks. That would be in the summer. In the winter, in the spring and the fall, I would water them once a month for rosemary. Very, very drought tolerant. So I have a little video clip from thewaterwise.com. It's a wonderful website from the Department of Water and Power of the City of Los Angeles that talks about how to water your landscape. And now I've been talking about ET and talking about inches per hour and microclimate and crop coefficient, but you really don't have to know all of that. Let's go to this video clip and then we'll talk about how to use this.
California landscape uses smart irrigation technology. This irrigation sprinkler system is applying water very evenly, efficiently, and can save us 40% of our water. That's good for our water supply, it's good for our budgets, and it's also good for our plants. There is a difference presently today. You see irrigation heads in the lawn that are 4-inch poplars that put on water in a fan spray fashion. Let me demonstrate that for you. This is a fan spray very commonly seen today in most of our landscapes. There's a lot of drift and a lot of waste in this type of an application, and it doesn't put on the water very uniformly. And it puts it on at such volume sometimes that the soil can't absorb it. When that happens, the water that can't be absorbed runs off down into our gutter in a physically extreme amount of water waste. California Valley Landscape uses a smarter technology. It uses a stream rotor, and it applies water a stream rotor that gently applies water to the grass and the landscape. Still absorbs it. There's virtually no runoff. The plants enjoy it, and it's a much healthier way for plants to be irrigated. And it's also fun to watch. If you notice, the stream rotor is more efficient. It moves through the landscape, and it applies water with great uniformity, great distribution uniformity. So if you're thinking about using irrigation technology in a California-friendly theme, go for the stream rotor. These sprinkler heads are about $5 a piece, and you're going to have to look for them at the irrigation landscape supply houses. You won't find them in nurseries and some of the mass merchandiser heads. If you go to bewaterwise.com, you'll find where you can purchase these heads. If you move into the shrub areas, there are four different types of irrigation devices that I'd like to show you that are low volume and really work with the California-friendly landscape. all of these devices, these drip emitters, drip systems, fine spray systems, put water right where the plant needs it, right in the root ball area. One example of an emitter that can be plugged into a poly pipe right through your garden is this fine little sprinkler that puts water right around the base of the plant. Another fine spray low volume device for large areas where you might have ground cover that can be directed to any location you like, right where the root zone is this fine spray system. And the third emitter is called a drip emitter, and these can be plugged right into the poly pipe. What's important with these emitters is that you want to have one on each side of the root ball. And so they just drip water right to the root zone area. And lastly, is an emitter that's an inline emitter that can be put around the root ball, plugged into the poly pipe. All this pipe can be hit by a layer of bulges, you never see it. And again, it just drips water into the area of the root zone where it's most advantageous for the plant. California-friendly irrigation systems are low flow. They put water right where the plant wants it. It's much better for our environment. It saves a tremendous amount of water. And to get more information about this, you can go to the website, bewaterwise.com. The most efficient way to water your landscape, believe it or not, is with a hose. And that's that person who walks around the garden early in the morning. We call them a hose dragger. It waters the garden with a hose and perhaps a nozzle. It's still the most efficient way to do that. Many of us are too busy to do that, and we have selected to use automatic controllers. Unfortunately, most of the controllers in the house today are old-fashioned controllers, and they water automatically, rain or shine, unless the homeowner goes out and adjusts those controllers during those weather changes. That doesn't happen very often. The smart controller is now coming onto the market. The California Friendly Controller waters it according to the weather. I have several controls that I want to show you that fit into this smarter weather tracking controller that I would suggest that you think about for your landscape. I have three controllers in front of me that I call smart controllers. These are weather tracking controllers. These are extremely efficient, and they water according to the weather and the temperature. This particular controller, it has historical weather information in it. It also has a temperature sensor that hangs to the outside of the garage or underneath the eave. That temperature sensor, along with its historical data, tells the controller how much water to apply and what time of the year. These two controllers are much more sophisticated, and they are actually satellite controlled. Every day, these controllers get a signal from the satellite telling them what the weather is like outside. These controllers then make that adjustment and then will water your landscape according to the weather. Therefore, it takes a lot of the guesswork out for those people who are busy and can't get out and change your controller every week. These controllers will do that for you. They're more expensive, they save a tremendous amount of water, and they're certainly much better for our plants as well as our...
Well, that's a really good little video for talking to you about the various types of sprinkler heads you can use in your garden. Those beta sprinkler heads, they tend to put on way too much of an application, and you get a lot of runoff, and you lose a lot of water to evaporation as water shoots through the air. So if you can go to one of these rotating heads, you'll go for lower application rate, which reduces runoff, and also will reduce the evaporation because the droplets are a little larger than on those fan heads. Now, I was talking about this publication from the Department of Water Resources at the University of California Cooperative Extension, and they define their water use for pine materials, as I mentioned, very low, moderate, and high. And so very low is 10%, and low is 10 to 30%, and moderate is 40 to 60%, and high is 70 to 90%. And what's really important is when you utilize this information, is that you group your plants according to their water needs. And this is important because if you've got plants that don't want to be watered a lot, and you put them in plants that have to be watered a lot, and then you water for the plant that needs more water, that plant, you're watering it too frequently, you're keeping it too wet. And the perfect example of this is when people grow fruit trees in a lawn. Now, Most fruit trees will do very well if they're irrigated once a month in the spring and the fall, and every 2 to 3 weeks in the summer, particularly citrus. And the reason for that is because one of the most important diseases of fruit trees and citrus in particular is phytophthora root rot. And the way you control phytophthora root rot is by restricting the frequency of your irrigation. If you water a citrus tree really frequently and you keep the soil wet, then you're going to get a lot of root rot. And your trees will then get tip dieback, you'll get yellow leaves, you'll get very poor flowering, you'll get very few fruit and small fruit, and the tree will slowly decline over years. So how do you water citrus? You soak it for several hours, or even, depending on your application rate, you're going to soak it to a depth of 3 feet, and then you're going to let it dry out for 2 to 4 weeks, depending on the season. In the spring, you're going to water it about once a month, and in the summer, you're going to water it about every 2 to 3 weeks, depending on your drainage and where you live. If you are in any clay, then you're going to be more like every 3 weeks, because clays drain and retain their water for long periods of time. If you're right along the coast, then you're going to water about every 3 weeks in the summer, because it's just not that hot. The only time you'd probably go up every 2 weeks if you're in a hot inland valley, and you have a very, very fast draining soil, sandy soil or sandy loam, you might want to water every 2 weeks. But you can leave that period between irrigations by putting down a thick layer of mulch under the canopy of your tree. Now, you can't really do that very well if you plant your trees in a lawn. So many people call me up and they're having problems with their fruit trees and they're in a lawn. You should not have your trees in a lawn. Lawns use so much water and you have to water them so frequently, they're just incompatible with most trees and shrubs. Now, there are some trees that will do very well in a lawn. Magnolias tend to be very, they do well. They're from a very wet climate, but especially magnolia grandiflora, the southern magnolia. It's from the south of the United States. They get rain there all summer, and so they do pretty well in the lawn. Well, you get a lot of surface rooting because you're not really watering to develop deep roots. You're watering just the surface very frequently. And that's another thing that happens when you plant trees in lawns, is because you're regularly watering the surface of the upper 6 inches to 10 inches, then you end up getting a lot of fruits growing right on the surface of the soil instead of getting roots that grow deep in the soil down to 3 to 5 feet. Although 5 feet is a little deep, and about 80% of the roots are going to occur in the top 2 to 3 feet of the soil for trees and shrubs. And so when you water, you want to water that deeply. Now, in that video clip, it showed some really interesting ways to water your shrubs with either bubblers or drip emitters, or that ring that just drips. The problem with that is it's hard to know your application rate or something like that. It's hard to know how many inches you're actually applying. So when you use that type of sprinkler, you want to take a soil probe, either a metal rod or something like a metal rod, and after you've watered for maybe 30 minutes or maybe an hour, take your rod and shove it into the soil and see how deep it will go. When you get to the dry soil, it will be much more difficult to push that rod into the ground. And it'll probably just come to a stop. You may need to press it in a couple spots to make sure you're not just hitting a rock or something. But then that'll give you a reference. You know that after 30 minutes, it went down about 12 inches. And after 60 minutes, it went down 18 inches or something like that. And then you know that if after 2 hours, it went down 28 inches. So it really took 2 hours of dripping. Or maybe even 3 or 4 hours of dripping to soak the soil to a depth of 2 to 3 feet. And those drip emitters are great because they have almost no evaporation loss while the water is being applied. And you get almost no runoff, so it's an excellent way to water. But then you have to know how long to run. And typically it will take a number of hours to soak the soil to that depth. Now, behind me you can see wonderful magnolia grandiflora. Let's bring it up full screen and take a quick look at it. This is a magnolia grandiflora. They're very common, a street tree. And I think the most common problem that you get with these is they don't get enough water because they are native to an area. The sun in the United States, they get a lot of summer water. And typically when I see them in cutouts along sidewalks. They're doing very poorly, and I think it's mostly due to a lack of water. They have a very large, thick glossy leaf, which is really, really pretty, and a big white flower, which is really, really nice. So, the different regions that are covered in the estimated irrigation water needs of landscape planting in California. Our region 1 is the North Central Coast, and region 2 is the Central Valley. Region 3 is the South Coast, and Region 4 is the South Inland Valley. That would be the San Fernando Valley, and the San Fernando Valley, valleys like that. 5 and 6 are the deserts. 5 is the intermediate and high desert, and Region 6 is the low desert. And as you might guess, you need to use a lot more water in the hot inland valleys and not in the desert. So plants that might be low water use along the coast will be moderate inland. And a good example of that is camellias. And we've talked a little bit about camellias, maybe because my background with camellias, I curated the camellia collection at the Huntington Botanical Gardens for 3 years. And camellias are very, very popular, especially in the San Gabriel Valley, where you see them in almost every home has a camellia somewhere around the house. They do really well on the north side or the east side of your home, where they'll get morning light and be protected from the afternoon sun. Now, this is just a comment I want to make. Last week in the Los Angeles Times, there was an article in the Then and Now section of the Times. And they had interviewed the director of Descanso Gardens. And it may be true that to some extent, camellias are not as popular as they once were because they are a higher water use plant than a lot of people are interested in now. A lot of people are very interested in using low water use plants. That's great. But if you read that article, they said that camellias were water hogs. Well, camellias really aren't water hogs. They are actually moderate water use. And if you put them on the north side of your house and get them established, you can water them very little, about twice a month in the spring and the fall, and once a week in the summer. And you don't have to water them a whole lot. And roses out in the full sun will use more water than camellias, quite clearly. Roses are more of around 60% of ET. And I would water my camellias at around 40 to 50% BT. So I use less water on my camellias than I use on my roses. Roses are out in the full sun. In the summer, when it gets really hot, I might water my roses as much as twice a week. I make big basins around them and fill them up repeatedly. I don't grow a lot of roses, but I do grow some roses. Roses are by far the most popular landscape plant in probably the world, for that matter. You get a tremendous amount of flowers. And for really a very inexpensive plant, you get more flowers from a rose bush than you'll get from any other plant in your landscape. And they should perform for you year after year after year and do very, very well. So, if we move on, what I find in most lawn situations is the newer landscape, newer irrigation systems with PVC pipe and the standard pop-up sprinkler heads apply upwards of 2 inches an hour. And so if you're running for 15 minutes, you get about a half an inch. So generally speaking, if you run your system for about 15 minutes, you'll put down about a half an inch. And if you do that twice a week in the spring and the fall, then that's about an inch. And in the summer, you're going to need to go up and do that for about you're going to do it 3 times a week, and that's going to give you about an inch and a half. Now, here behind you, we see a lot of trees growing in a park with a lawn. And if we can go back to that picture, I wanted to make a comment about that. We'll take a look at it. Now, these trees are from the glasses, so I make sure I know what I'm looking at. These are probably eucalyptus or melaleuca, which are basically kind of the same in terms of water use. And they are planted in a lawn, and you see them in lawns, and they do okay. But it would be best if you could have a big circle around here with no lawn, and if the sprinklers were designed so that there's water around the base of the tree, and then the tree can be watered separately once a month. Most of our large shade trees, that, especially if they're Mediterranean, things like eucalyptus, which are actually Australian, Melaleuca, which is Australian. A lot of our pines, the Canary Island pine, the Aleppo pine, tide zone pine. These come from very dry regions. They have a Mediterranean climate, the same climate as we have. We are cool and wet in the winter, and we are warm and dry, or hot and dry, in the summer. So those plants do very, very well here, but they only need to be irrigated once a month. So if you put these pines in an area with a lawn, and you're watering it there frequently, you typically develop root rot. Just the same as citrus. If you water citrus too frequently, you end up with root rot, and you end up with the tree declining. So if you've had any of these kind of problems, you can call in, and I can try to help you control those problems and correct those problems. Our phone number is 1-800-339-1193. Now, let's take a look at some more trees and talk a little bit about some trees. Let's go to our next picture of a tree, and we'll bring it up, and we'll talk about that tree and talk about its water needs. Now, let's bring this up full size. This is a caribou tree, and caribous are very groundwater. It's a good replacement tree for caribs. And the problem with caribs is the females make very large pods, and then they're prone to rot. So, caribou, if we look at caribou, let's look at caribou's caribouses, and I'll bet you it's in our guide, and we'll see what they say for watering caribouses. Caribouses. I'm surprised they don't have caribou's caribouses. They refer to it as moderate, so that would be 40% to 50% of ET in all regions. Except they don't have a hot desert, and it may not be a good tree for the hot desert, although occasionally I do see it out in Palm Springs area. But this is a medium-sized tree, about 20 to 30 feet. It makes small green berries, which are not that much of a little problem. It's a very good tree, and people like it for its replacement for the caribs. The caribs got a little bigger than that. They got about 30 to 40 feet in height, and they developed those long pods, which are really a litter problem. They also develop a lot of rot, they're prone to rot, and they'll drop large branches and you'll end up with a hollow trunk after about 25 to 50 years. I see we have a caller online. Beverly calling from San Fernando, you're on the air.
Hi there. I'm trying to get the publication number and the information to order the publication.
The publication, let me give that to you again. Now, I found this by just by searching on Google. And I was very happy to find it. And you can get it from the Department of Water Resources, Bulletins and Reports, P.O. Box 942-836, Sacramento, California. Their zip code is 94236. And you can also call them at 916-653-1097. This is a free publication. And they should send you that. I just printed it right off the internet. And you can see it's exclusive. And I have it three whole posted in front of the phone, which my colleagues from the work keep telling me to do. Do you have any other questions, everybody? Let's see if you use that. On the front page. You know, it doesn't give a bulletin number, at least on the beginning. You know, it doesn't give a bulletin number. But the title is Estimating Irrigation Water Needs of Landscape Plantings in California.
Okay, thank you very much.
The landscape coefficient.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, you're welcome. Thank you for calling. So we were taking a look at a variety of trees now, and let's look at some more pictures of trees. If you have a question about a tree that we're looking at, call us up at 1-800-339-1193. Now this tree is a eucalyptus bluegum. And you can see what happened to this tree as it fell over. And bluegums are fast-growing trees that are used extensively in Southern California as wind breaks in agricultural areas. This one was in a park in Los Angeles, and I got a call from a colleague of mine who worked for the Department of Recreation and Parks, and she wanted me to take a look at this and try to figure out why it fell over. But I know that bluegums always end up falling over eventually, unless they're cut down and removed. This tree had a trunk about 4 foot in diameter. It was probably nearly an 80 to 100 foot tree. And it was just asking to fall over. And what I found was that the root system was rather shallow. Probably meaning it didn't get a whole lot of deep water in. Plus it had quite a bit of rot in it. So this tree failed due to root failure. And probably poor watering over the life of the tree. So it didn't have a lot of deep, deep roots. And of course, some trees are really prone to falling over. And in my experience, it's eucalyptus, pines, and oaks, especially the California coastline oak, as they age. Usually when they're younger, they don't tend to fall over that much. But as they get older and bigger, they do. Now, deciduous trees usually don't fall over in winter storms very often or at all because they have no leaves and they don't catch the wind. Whereas eucalyptus are evergreen, the pines are evergreen, the California coastline oak is evergreen. After we get a good soaking like we've had over this winter, if we get a good wind, then the canopy will catch that wind and it's very likely that you can have trees come down under these conditions. The other one that I see coming out a lot is the Grevillea robusta, which is the silk oak. It is not grown very much anymore, and a lot of communities removed it entirely because of its tendency to drop large branches or blow over in windstorms. Some of these guys come in, you know, naturally do produce rather shallow root systems, and so they're prone to falling over in high winds. And if you've got one of these huge trees, they're upwards of 80 feet, close to 100 feet tall, they're extremely hazardous trees. And eventually, you'll be better off just removing the whole tree rather than waiting for it to fall. And that's probably what you should do then. Let's take a look at our next picture of a tree. And let's, okay, you're seeing these bloom all over town right now. This is a flowering pear, which is Pyrus calathea. And they are spectacular. This one is particularly spectacular. I took this over in the San Fernando Valley. Now, this says that the pears do get a disease called fireblight. And other than that, they don't have a lot of problems. Here you can see a close-up of the flowers themselves. This is a wonderful tree. They get to about 20 to 30 feet in height. They do quite well as a street tree. Now, the disease they do get is called fireblight. That's a bacterial disease that starts on the flowers. And the flower gets infected with the bacteria. It runs down the pedicel into the twigs and causes a canker, which will gum and bleed. And the bacteria is being reproduced in that gummy exudate. Bees are attracted to that gummy exudate. And then they go and they introduce the bacteria to the flowers. And that's the cycle, basically. So, if it rains a lot when the tree is blooming, then the bees will get a lot of the bacteria on them, and you'll get a lot of infections. And typically what happens is that bacteria runs down into a twig, and down that twig into a larger branch, and then it girdles that. And then you get about maybe a 3 foot length of branch dies in the canopy. We call that flagging. So you'll see these dead branches scattered in the canopy. And it's a big problem in commercial apple and pear production. And it's a problem on this tree because this is a flowering pear, often called evergreen pear or flowering pear. And so the way you control that is you prune out the dead branches. And you want to go at least 12 inches below the dead wood because this bacteria is called Erwinia amylogna. this bacteria tends to run down the stem or the branch on one side in a narrow little strip. And so you need to make sure you go well below the infected wound. And often you hear that you need to clean your shears when you're pruning. In this particular case, when you're pruning out the dead infected branches from fire blight and pear trees, you in fact do need to clean your shears between every cut. And you want to either use Lysol or maybe light alcohol, 5% alcohol, rubbing alcohol and water, and a little mister bottle, and you can just squirt your shears with that between each cut. Or if you use a lopper or a saw, you want to clean your saw between each cut. Because if you get the bacteria on your pruning tools and then go make another cut, you're going to move the bacteria from one cut wound to the next wound. You're just going to move the bacteria around. But generally, when you're cleaning your shears, you only need to prune, clean your pruning equipment between each plant, particularly if you're pruning or working on orchids. After you've worked on an orchid, you clean your shears so you don't move a virus from plant to plant. But you don't have to clean between each cut on the same plant. With this, with fire blight on pears, clean your shears between each cut. Now, there is just to continue about that particular disease, fire blight. When you, if we're getting a lot of rain and it's blooming, there is a product you can spray the tree with. It's called Alliette. It's spelled Alliette. It's primarily used to control Phycophthora rubrii, but it is also labeled for the control of fire blight on pears and apples. And fire blight can affect a few other members of the rose family, such as Pyracantha and Raphanopsis, which is in hawthorn, but I rarely see it on that. I do see it quite consistently on flowering pears, and they are spectacular when they bloom, and they should be blooming all over town right now. Wonderful tree, nice tree for color. Although it's white, it's still color in my book. Now, this next tree we have here, we'll bring this up full picture, and I'll show you this tree. Let's go full screen here. This is a deodar cedar, Cedrus deodara. It is a true cedar. And you can see that this one has been thinned a little too much. You don't want to thin them quite this much. The general guidelines for pruning trees are never remove more than 25% of the canopy in a single pruning. And avoid any large wounds. Anything over 2 inches is considered a large wound. And pruning with plants in the natural form. Now you can see this tree is basically pruned to enhance the thinning. Let's bring it up full screen because I want to point out one more thing on this before we run out of time. Let's bring that back up full screen. Now you can see right here, it divides. Let's see if I can arrow. There we go. Right there, you can see that it divides into 2 liters, 2 centromeres. We call that codon in liters. And probably at some point in time, somebody topped this tree. And that's what happens with the top leaders, is we have the codon leaders and branches attached. If you've been watching Gardens in California, I've been your host, Jerry Murray. Thank you for watching. And next week, we're going to be talking about vegetable gardens, how to prepare for your vegetable gardens, and the wide variety of tomatoes, peppers, and everything else. So until then,